report on the 2nd of October, I committed to presenting a separate report to members explaining how we would achieve the whole target and including on the form appliances. What I said at the time, you may recall that we've received very little interest from existing staff to undertake all time retain contracts, and we've sought expressions of interest on two occasions previously in order to do that. The contractual options if you like to achieve all time retained and the associated implications thereof are listed in paragraphs 11 through 19 in the report, which is on pages 50 to 52. What I'd like to do is to focus specifically on paragraph 13, which provides the detail on the individual options, and in the late chair, I'll just explain those in a little bit more detail. Ostensibly, we have four options to consider, realistically. The first would be the outright recruitment of community retained firefighters. Now, I don't intend to go over the old ground as to why that's not something that I recommend that we do, despite the fact that clearly Ken Knight was of the view that that was the future in terms of the Bootle Fire Rescue Service. And it's clear that DCLG, or certainly our civil service colleagues, share that view. And that is something we could do. We could seek to recruit community retained firefighters. And there is no question in my mind that there would be a lot of people who would apply if we re-advertised those roles. Remember, previously, the last recruitment campaign we undertook was the recruitment of full-time staff for 21-hour contracts, so effectively part-time staff. And that is something that we could do, although to just do that in isolation in itself would not deliver the additional flexibility around and retained that we require. And there are other issues there around retention as much as anything, because the view expressed by the staff on the 21-hour contracts is, despite the fact that in any given week they may well have worked in excess of 42 hours on occasion, if they were attempting to secure a mortgage or something of that nature, then that could only be viewed on the basis of their contracted 21 hours. Now, that is not to say, members, that in discounting that option at this point in time, that isn't to say that we might not have to come back and revisit that. But the next two options that I'll speak to, the first of which I suspect will be less palatable, but the reality is it may well be something we have to consider, and hopefully bringing us on then to the final option, which is the one at this point in time I favour in truth for the reasons which I'll explain. The third option is the recruitment of, in essence, what we talked about first was a retained contract under 20 hours. But what you could do under the auspices of that contract is offer people additional shifts, additional voluntary hours. In truth, you could offer them in excess of 42 hours, and we would undoubtedly have the shifts available to give them that additional work. You might take a cynical view that was akin to a zero-hours contract, and whilst in truth it wouldn't strictly speaking be a zero-hours contract, because there would be a guaranteed 10% retaining fee, and the reality is that is a contract that's in operation throughout the country. The majority of the country is covered by retained firefighters. And as I've said previously with the 21-hour contracts, that's not to say that we might not have to consider that at some point in the future. And we might, members, and I need to make that really clear, that we might have to do that. The final option is to offer a 32-hour contract. And the reason that you would offer 32 hours is because that would give you the option of 8, 12, or indeed 24-hour shifts, averaged out over an 8-week reference period, indeed over an 8-day reference period if needs be. but to also offer a 42-hour whole-time retained contract, because that, in the end, is the primary objective. And if we recruited people on 32 hours, then the reality is they would absolutely end up doing 42 hours a week. But the sum, if you like, of a 32-hour contract equates to it, and with the 42 hours whole-time retained, equates to about 85% of the firefighter's salary. So that's in excess of £20,000 a year for a competent firefighter. So whilst it's not the same and clearly a competent firefighter on 42 hours would be on £28,000 a year, if you add on the 10% retainment fee, of course that adds another £2,800 onto that. And that isn't to say that absolutely certain that these people would be earning the full amount of the fact that every other firefighter is on. But this is about flexibility, and it is about achieving whole-time retained, not community retained, because we want to maintain fire appliances crewed by firefighters who have the levels of competence that our whole-time staff have. I know that's an argument that I've been asked previously on numerous occasions, and I don't propose to go back through that. So at this point in time, that would be my preference for the reasons that I've explained. What I would say is that discussions continue with our colleagues from the Fire Brigade Union and the Fire Officers Association as to how we might encourage more of our existing whole-time staff to take on retained contracts. That work is being treated as a priority. We've got Mark and Kevin here today, and we were discussing this very issue when we met yesterday at our monthly meeting. It is something that's being progressed through the Joint Secretaries as a priority. And it may well be that we are able to attract sufficient staff to crew the four full-time retained pumps. And if we are, then of course this becomes academic. And that's absolutely something that then we would revisit in terms of the recruitment. So just to reassure members, that is the priority. We can achieve this through existing staff, and that is absolutely what we want. Well, I undertook to bring to you options as to how we would achieve a whole-time retained plan, so that we couldn't attract sufficient numbers of existing staff, and that is I've described for you there. What I would say is that in any event, we are still going to need to recruit, albeit small numbers. And that may appear on the face of it irrational based on the numbers of firefighters, or the number of firefighter posts that we're going to need to lose in order to meet the current savings targets and what we know almost certainly is going to come in the next spending review in terms of the cuts that the authority is likely to face thereafter. The point I would make is, as of today, we employ, I think it's 787 firefighters as of today, which is, we have a budget for 764, so we're employing more people than we actually should have. We're aware of this, we're using reserves to avoid compulsory redundancies. But that figure over the course of the next 5 years, so up to 2020, that figure would drop to below 500 through retirement, so it would be down by financial year 2020-21, we'd be down to 413 firefighters. Now, I've said to you previously, the 2020 vision, we're assuming having just under 600 firefighters there, if the scale of the financial challenge continues in the way we expect it to. So you can see over the next 5 years, what we wouldn't want to do is to be in a position where we had to recruit a lot of people all at once because of the succession planning issues around operational competencies and so forth. So what we're saying is that we will need to recruit in any event, but it's just a question of the type of contracts onto which we recruit. That is the issue that we need to reconcile. And just to stress the point again, in the first instance, if we are able to resolve the whole-time retained issues through the existing workforce, that is what we will do as a priority, and we are all committed to doing that. That's myself, that's Phil, that's our colleagues in the FBU, and the just to reassure you members, that succession plan initiative is something we've raised previously. We do have a reserve, a recruitment reserve, which is earmarked in the recruitment previously, to allow us to do that in such a way that it doesn't impact on the financial plan. Details of the positive action campaign undertaken to date are listed at paragraphs 20 to 23, which is on page 52. The details of the recruitment process follows at paragraphs 24 to 28. Paragraphs 29 to 32 detail the research that's been undertaken by our people and organisational development team in relation to firefighter apprenticeships, which is something that we are very, very keen to explore further. And when we have sufficient detail in that regard, we will bring the report back to the to consider and need to take the view on that. I'll pause at that point, Chair, conscious of that we spoke a bit longer than I wanted to, but I think it was important just to explain the issues.
Yeah. Thank you,
Chair.
I understand the argument for recruiting, because over time we'll lose too many, and it's about sustainability of and continuity in the workforce. But just on those two, the second and the fourth option on page 51, is there any impact of either of those on the degree and level and type of training that firefighters would have? Because I think really it's crucial that they are all trained to those same high standards we already have.
And I think in truth, Barbara, that is the reason for the, if you like, with the 32 Act, all of the firefighters, any firefighter that we recruit, will undergo what will be now a 24-week recruit course, which is focused very much on the operational skill acquisition. The point I made previously around the amount of hours they would actually work, it might be 42 hours, but possibly more, undoubtedly. Therefore, will be exposed to exactly the same amount of training and potential resources than the staff that we have now. That is why it is predicated in the way that we want to design the options.
Great, that's reassuring.
Thanks, Chair. If you can, sometimes the problem with attending when you go for option four, you'll have people at the end of the day who are actually coming on these contracts and will be working 85% of firefighters' wage. Will they be told up front that they will be working with people physically working with them? And maybe will be on less pay? Because a lot of time, that causes a lot of antagonism amongst people, and it's very hard to address. And the other thing I was going to ask is, if you're so sure they'll go to 42 hours, and you'll offer them the extra shifts, can the shifts be pensionable? Because, again, it's money for your time.
To the best of two good points there, and I'm glad you raised that, because it does give me the opportunity to. In terms of the 85% figure, that is a purely factual figure based on the pro rata salary. The reality is, I don't remember, the people that we bring in on these contracts will be offered additional shifts, undoubtedly. Hence the flexibility, that's why we need to do it this way. When Ken Knight reported in his efficiencies review, he made the point around the very rigid inefficiency of the existing full-time duty system. And there's no denying that it is rigid and it is very inflexible. What we're trying to do here is to circumvent some of that inflexibility in truth to allow us to maintain that as a duty system. For these individuals, in theory, you look, they're getting paid less than the month, they get paid exactly the same, the hourly rate would be exactly the same. It's just the amount of contracted hours would be different. In reality, not that they would work the same number potentially in their lives. The issue around the pensionability, the additional hours that they work would be worked on their retained contract, which is pensionable in its own right. Therefore, they would make it, they in effect would accrue two pensions, the whole time pension and the retained pension. So effectively, they'd be getting two, which when you combine them both would amount to the same, because it would be the same pension, it's going to be the 2015 pension scheme. It will be two pensions on the same scheme, if that makes sense. I know that on the face of it might sound confusing, but I suppose if I take the second job in the same job, if that makes sense, it'd be like in Santander having two jobs doing exactly the same thing, but two contracts, both of which would be pensionable. It's just one of those nuances that's peculiar to the Fire and Rescue Service. But to reassure you, the additional hours would be pensionable unless they chose to opt out of the pension.
My question's just been asked to you.
Okay. I'll get this figure
around. Excuse me, Chair.
Put this figure around the telescope. If we end up in a situation where an employee, a firefighter, actually says, actually, I only want to work for extra hours a week, I don't want the extra hours a week, how does that fit in your plan?
In that sense, that would be absolutely fine, because we would still have more than enough shifts to accommodate that wish. And the reality is, we do have staff who work reduced hours.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
We do, so we would accommodate that in the same way as we accommodate existing staff. But if somebody did just wish to work 32 hours, the reality is, and they couldn't do that on. It couldn't be two days, two nights, because that would be 42 hours at 1,000. The very fact that it is less than that, that is what derives the flexibility. I can't dress it up any other way. This is bringing in self-mastery, which is what we need to do in order to make us more flexible, more responsive to what we need to be, and to circumvent some of the challenges that Ken Wright has raised, if you like, through the efficiencies with you. Now, I'll make no secret of this. This is circumventing the inefficiencies of the labour. That is what we're trying to do here. But we are trying to do it for the right reasons. It is to maintain whole time crewing, but to do so in a way which is as cost effective as it can be. Because, of course, the most cost effective way to do this is retention.
I think the point I was trying to get at, Chair, was that we would end up in a situation where somebody is on space of 32-hour contract and then effectively be obliged to do those extra hours. That's the issue I was trying to get at.
Sorry, apologies.
Yeah, no, it's okay. I think you answered my question. In fact, they wouldn't get obliged to do those extra hours. That's what I was getting at.
It's kind of a flow of questions. We're considering the open phase option, which is option 4. We very happily describe why we have to take the option. You described before that you were still in consultation with the staff side of the unions about this matter, and you might be able to resolve it within, as part of those negotiations. Is there a particular time scale that you're envisaging?
That engagement with the rep bodies is that's our number one priority. We've prioritised it. The issues in relation to the HR policies I don't want to speak out of turn here, Mark, but I believe we're not far off resolution in that regard. That was the only other outstanding issue in terms of the mutual relations that needed to be resolved. And so Mark has just confirmed that we are at the point of resolution. That means all of our effort now will be expended on seeking resolution to the issue around the full-time retained. To make the point that we still need to future-proof the operational response model, because the game here is to maintain full-time. Therefore, the point Barbara made earlier on, helpfully, is to maintain the highest standard of operational competence and therefore response in terms of the service and the quality of the service that we deliver.
Any other comments or questions? Matt, would you like to make any comment?
No, other than to say we've never sort of moved away from the fact that despite the FPU's view on maintaining the same supplies. My own personal belief is that whole-time firefighters taking the same contract gives a much more in-depth skill set. And we've never been sacrificed from that service, and I was going to say the same, that creating our vision for the way forward. The body of work at the moment is up to the 18th of November, I think the date is the 7th of August. The body of work is around how do we achieve that, and bring all our firefighters along to get to the course centre to take up those contracts and get the best possible conditions within those contracts as well. So the work is ongoing, and I'm really interested to get that as well by hopefully by the 18th of November.
Thank you. Can I just ask all the members of the UC?
Yes.
And the outside of that, Vice Chancellor. So it's quite a long recommendation. Is there a way that the recruitment process contained in the English report? And then it's an opening note. The recruitment and training firefighters in flexible contractual arrangements specified within the report specifically a combined 32-hour wartime short, 42-hour. Full-time training contract, average over 7-day period, is there really not an endorse? That the feasibility and recruitment firefighters on 120 hours retained contract is exploring all future proofs of recruitment and maximise flexibility. Is there really not an endorse? And the development of apprenticeship model for future recruitment. Next item is item 5, which is an exemption of people leaving, thank you for the commitments today.